small compromises lead to great disaster. RU principle number five.
Yeah.
Small compromises lead to great disaster. But sometimes we call it little sins lead to big sins. Now, why do we have to be careful with that when we say that in that manner? We don't characterize sin as little or big, do we? Sin is sin.
Well, God sees sin as sin, yeah.
Sin is sin is sin. But it helps us in our logical human thinking recognize that. That's not spiritual logic, that's human logic. And we think about little sins leading to big sin. And we're going to talk about tonight little things leading to bigger things. So, again, number one, say, and let's say, let's go ahead and open your Bibles up to Luke. Chapter number 16. He gives us a verse that we can kind of base this on and bounce off of.
What verse?
Luke chapter 16, verse number 10.
Okay.
Now, let me kind of tell you the story there, give you the context of what's going on in this, in where this verse comes from in Luke chapter 16. It where we at, starting along there in verse number 16, start at verse number 10, says, "He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much, and he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much." Now, the principle they're talking about here, in fact, in one, another place in the Bible, they use the story of a man that went away, a nobleman, a man that owned a lot of property, and he would, I guess you could say, he was maybe like a landlord too, had a lot of different houses, pieces of land, and he had money. And so when he was going away for a while, and he left money with three of his stewards, he left a certain amount with each one of them, and when he came back, he wanted to give an accounting of it. And so the one had taken it, and like he had $100, he had turned it into $200. And he told him, "You've done a good job. You've taken this money that I've given you, and you've been faithful steward over it. You've taken good care of it. You've increased it. And you've done a good job." And another one came, and he had $100, and he turned it into $300. He told him, "You've done well, good service, a good job. You've taken that money, you've increased it, you've turned it into something more, it's been productive." And he told him, "You've done a good job." But one of them, he gave $100 to. When he came back, all he had was still that $100. He didn't do anything with it. He just held on to it. And that was his point. That was what he told the nobleman when he come back. He wanted the nobleman to think that he'd been a good steward because he had maintained and held on to that $100. Now, we'll touch that here in just a minute. And as we think about this idea of little sins and big sins and treasures and holding on to things, over the book of Matthew chapter 6, it talks about treasures. And we know the Bible says that where your heart is, your treasure will be. Over Matthew chapter 6, it talks about laying up treasures and storing away treasures. And we can understand that principle. Treasure is something that you put away for future use. And I always use the example of Captain Kidd, the pirate. He was always in search of treasure. And what was that treasure? It was where someone, maybe him or somebody else, had maybe robbed the ship and they'd taken that money and they took it to an island somewhere and they buried it on that island and then come back and they dig up that treasure. It was stored away for future use. And we understand that problem, that concept of treasure and stored away things for future use. But we also understand the principle of the concept of taking what God has given us and doing something productive with it, like he talked about giving that $100 and turning it into $200. In other words, the whole principle is not just to maintain. And sometimes that's where we get, and that's why this principle can be so helpful to us. In our recovery from addictive behavior, stubborn strongholds in our life, sometimes when we gain a little victory or we get to a certain point, we just want to stay right there. I'm going to hold on. I'm not going any further. Now, that's true, and holding on, not slipping back is a good thing. But what we need to do is take that victory that God has given us and use it and turn it into more victories and turn it into more victories and not just maintain right there where we are. It's kind of like that process. If you're not going forward, you're slipping back. If you're not growing, you're shrinking. If you're not gaining knowledge, you're losing knowledge. And that's kind of what we think about. How do we get into that place? We want to hold on. We want to maintain. But if we're not careful, those small compromises will cause us to slip away. And then before we know it, wrap it up, we're in a big mess. We're right back out there in what we used to be in. Or we're engaged in that stronghold. Satan's got that stronghold in our life again, and we're being like we used to be. So let's talk about this a little bit. He says, according to Luke 16:10, we want to be faithful in the big things, then we must be faithful in the little things. Before God, you know, I've always said that God never intends me to be a millionaire because I wouldn't know how I am. So he keeps me right on that line. You know, right on that line, just going under sometimes. You know, so he knows that if he dumped it all out, I'd be an idiot. Ain't no telling what happened. So he wants us to learn, though, to be faithful with the little thing. And when we learn to be faithful with little things, guess what? He'll give us a bigger thing. He is not going to give us any more victory than we can handle. Does that make sense to you? Yeah. What happens sometimes when we get, and you know this, if you've recovered from some addictive behavior, destructive behavior, what happens sometimes when we get that little bit of victory? We kind of get a big head, won't we? Boy, look what I've done. We'll even turn around and say to our friends, well, I've recovered from that. I stopped that. Why don't you stop that? Start making comparison. But what we've got to remember is every victory comes from God. And everything that we have comes from Him. And He wants us to be faithful with the little thing. Today we had a great, great testimony time. I mean, I know there's a small number of us here, but boy, we had some good testimony. But as soon as we walk away from that testimony time, what happened? Satan started trying to intervene and disrupt and take over, and he always will. And so we have to be faithful in the little things. What sustains us through a Friday night sometimes is that little bit of testimony. That'll sustain us. And if we're faithful to give that little testimony, it may not seem like a big deal to anybody else, but it's a little testimony. If we'll give that little testimony, then one time we'll have a big testimony. He'll give us more victory. He'll give us more to talk about. So let's move on a little bit, talk a bit. We're going to be faithful in the big things, remaining victorious, then we must be faithful in the little things. I'm going to kind of move through these first two, but I want to get down to the last one a little bit. Number two says, if you are not yielding yourself to the little request of God, you will yield yourself to the little request of the enemy. The little request of God. Now, our God asks us to do things. In fact, the Bible says that He requires us to be faithful. And we know from principle number one, we know from reading God's Word that there's certain things that God don't want us to do. And He'll say, stay away from that. It may be a little thing. I think testimony was mentioned tonight about Tom and Jack and Captain Morgan. Just little things that can get in the way. But if we say no to those little things, it keeps us from getting into a bigger thing, a bigger problem. So God will ask us to do little things. He'll ask us to adjust our attitude.
Amen.
You ever had God ask you to adjust your attitude?
Oh, yes.
I've told y'all before many times, my wife is a great attitude adjuster.
Uh-oh.
She don't ever have to put her hands on her, really, to speak to her. She'll say, well, you know, you're a preacher. Or she'll say, you know, that tag on the front of your truck says chaplain.
Ooh.
And what does that do? It adjusts my attitude right quick, don't it? Because it reminds me. Sometimes God just asks us to adjust our attitude. Sometimes He asks us to be kind.
Yeah.
Sometimes He asks us to be forthright. Sometimes He asks us to be bold. Sometimes He just asks us to do little things. And until we learn to do those little things, guess what? There's not going to be any big thing. You know, I hear people, and I know there's some contemporaries of mine, I mean by that, I mean big men that are my age, that started off into ministry about the same time I did and made that profession, that jump of moving from secular world into full-time ministry. And where God asked them to, you know, just be be pastor here in this little small church. That wasn't good enough for them. They didn't want that. They want a big church. God asked them, well, just teach this Bible study on Tuesday night. Well, they didn't want to teach Bible study. They wanted to pastor church. Or God asked them to do just some little small something, to be faithful in doing that. But they had bigger sites. I want to be a pastor of a church, 200. I want to be a pastor of a church, 300. I want to be a televangelist, or I want to be a revival speaker. But God asked them first to teach here, or to preach here. You know, I started preaching, first preaching engagement I ever had was in the nursing home. I remember Brother Ralph Taylor, I went and talked to him, and he pastored Oakside Head, and I told Brother Ralph about calling on my life, and he said, well, find somewhere to preach. Preach. I said, well, I'm going where to preach. Nobody asked me to come preach. What am I going to do? Go tell a pastor, I need to move aside, I need to preach. He said, go back to the nursing home and preach. You can always preach at the nursing home. You can preach at the nursing home every Sunday. And you know what? I did. Every Sunday. In fact, one time I was preaching three nursing homes on Sunday afternoon. I've got my wife and kids going with me. Small little thing. And I've had men, that jump up and say, oh, I want to be in full-time ministry. I want, yeah, let me come along. Let me show me what to teach me. Help me be in full-time. I said, all right, let's go down to the nursing home on Sunday. And they come one Sunday, maybe two. Faded by. Why? They didn't want to do the little thing. They had bigger sights. They wanted God to give them ministry. God said, well, start off right here. Here's people with you every day right here. Start off with them. So, see, if we'll be faithful in those little things, then God will grow us and move us along. And one day there'll be big things in our life. But we got to be faithful in those little things. If you're not yielding yourself to the little request of God, you'll yield yourself to the little request of the enemy. And Satan will. Now, won't he sneak in there and ask you to do something? Yeah. Satan will sneak in and make requests of you and ask you to do it. If you're not going to do it for God, you do it for him. Romans 6:16 says, know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Making that comparison, doing the little things for God are doing the little things for the enemy. Small things determine who our master is. Small things. Our daily pattern of life. The daily circumstances of what we do, where we go, how we act, that's what determines who our master is. It's not the great big things that we say. You ever heard anybody say the devil's in the details? And that's what that means. It's exactly what that means. It's the small little things of our life that Satan will get involved in and distract us from the great victories that God has planned for us. The small little bit of that. Now, let's go to the number three, because that's where I really want to get into the lesson. I'll get the point across. Number three says, commit today to do the little things every day. Commit today to do the little things every day. And I wrote in my notes, everyday things, simple things. You know, we make the Christian walk complicated sometimes. We make it very complicated. We make it out to be like, well, I can't be a good Christian because I don't know enough scripture. Or I can't be a good Christian because I don't know how to share the gospel with somebody. Or I can't be a good Christian and just go on and on and on, offering up all these little small things about why we can't be a good witnessing Christian. It's God working in the everyday, normal circumstances of our life that will help us get solidified and faithful so that God can do bigger things with us. He'll never give us a big task till we learn to do the little task. Now, everybody in here has probably worked in the working field out in the world some kind of way over the years. You don't go down to McDonald's. Well, I can't say that because it's not true anymore. You don't go up to the hospital and say, I want to be a nurse on the fifth floor. Or you don't go to the hospital and to say, I want to be a surgeon operating on people. No, you don't do that, do you? There's a whole lot of little steps you have to take until one day you can get to that place. I was going to say, you don't just go down to McDonald's and go up there and say, hey, I want to be a shift supervisor and go to work. Well, you used to, you couldn't, but you can do that now. I mean, they'll hire you straight in off the street to be a shift supervisor. Yeah. But the point I'm trying to make is there's little things, little steps we have to take to get to that place. Now, think about about these things. Daily things and simple things that God asks us to do every day. And I'm going to go through a few things here that we will let slip by because of great disaster in our life. What about a daily devotion time? Every day. God asks us to do that every day. God asks us to spend time with Him and His Word every day.
That's
a daily devotion time. You know what happens to us? Well, and I would pick on Ashley, but I would pick on Ashley. She said it. She said sometimes it was hit and miss. Sometimes it would be 3 or 4 days this week. I do my Proverbs and my journaling. Hey, you know what happens when I miss one day of my daily devotion time? My whole day ends up turned upside down.
Yeah.
And if I mess around there and miss 2 days, I'm off the track. I'm off the rail. You have to commit to do those simple little things. Now, you know what the greatest enemy that we have in doing the daily simple things in our life? It's time and time management.
Yeah.
I've been teaching RU all these years, and I tell people, if you intend to do the little things for God, like daily devotion, you got to be intentional about it, and you have to make the time. You will make time to do what you want to do.
So busy.
So, with Henry Brothers, how can I do? How can I make time? I said, what time do you get up in the morning? Well, I usually get up about 6:30 or 7. I said, what time do you have to be at work? Oh, 8 o'clock. So you get up at 6:30 or 7, and you got to be at work at 8. So that gives you an hour to get your bath, get your clothes on, get to work, get your breakfast on what?
Get up at 6.
Well, you know what you need to do? You need to back up at least 15 minutes or 30 minutes. Whatever. Rearrange that time.
Schedule it.
You will never, ever spend time in God's Word every day until you spend time in God's Word on the days you don't want to. If you get up in the morning and you don't feel like doing your devotion, guess what? That's exactly the day you better jump in there and do it.
Yeah.
Because if you don't, you end up a mess for the day. So, little thing. What about prayer? Well, that's part of my devotion time. It certainly is.
All
your
day.
Daily devotion time should include a time of prayer.
All day.
But what about prayer at other times as well? Engaging in a prayer life, an active prayer life.
All day.
Just a little thing. What does it take? It takes time. Mm-hmm. It don't take any special clothing. It don't take any special equipment. It don't take anything but your time to engage in. And what happens? Well, you know, I didn't have time to pray today. Really?
Ooh.
I didn't have time not to pray.
Yeah.
That's a dangerous thing. But you see, what I'm trying to say, I'm not picking on me, and I know as we go through these things, it runs through our minds exactly what we're doing and what we're not doing. But I'm not trying to be nitpicking somebody, but I'm trying to help you understand that these issues, these little things, most of them, most of the little compromises that we get engaged in, small compromises, simply involve a determination for us to rearrange our time and manage our time better.
Yeah.
It don't cost anything to pray and have a devotion time. Like I said, no special clothing, no special equipment, no special place. That's good to have a place to be there.
Nope.
But it don't require anything really of us but our time.
No pretty good
time. And so with time management, it's very important. What learning how to use that time. What about making choices about, talking about little things again, what kind of music do you listen to?
Yeah.
Now,
Christian music.
It's what you should listen to. I'm a little different, and I realize that. I mean, some of you think I'm a lot different, but I'm a little different. I can go all day long and never turn a radio on. Now, when I was in high school, if my vehicle was running, the radio was on. But we have to make choices about little things. And those little things include things like the music we listen to. And if you don't think music has an impact on you, you are naive.
Mm.
You're naive. And it's not just the fact that you're singing along or consciously aware of what's going. Music works, and I say this at the risk of being sounding weird, music works subliminally. You got music on in the background, it's oozing in and sinking in. Stop and listen to the words of the music you're listening to sometimes. I've told this, my folks here at this church, and I've told you many times, one of the things I've had the hardest time with in my life is Christian music. I love Christian music. I was the radio station manager of a gospel music radio station for 7 years. Southern gospel. Talking about contemporary gospel music, I was just, no, I don't want to hear it. But what the Lord took me to the woodshed about and had me realize was you need to listen to the words of the music. Just like I found words in contemporary Christian music that were good, are good, and edifying and uplifting and encouraging, also find words there that are heretical and off doctrine. Same thing with Southern gospel, same thing with any kind of music. Listen to the words of some of the country music you listen to, or some of the pop rock, or soft rock, or classic rock you listen to. Just listen to the words of, you know, one thing I found out, the Joy FM, 93.3, the station that a lot of people listen to around, you know, they've got an app where you can go to and it shows you the song, the lyrics to the songs. And that's what I do. If I hear one that I like, or somebody says, oh, Brother Jim, you like this song? And I'll listen to it, but I'll go to that app and I'll pull it up. Look at the lyrics, see what it says. So we have to make, that's a small choice, but it has a big impact on our life. Because it affects us, music influence. What about the TV we watch?
Ooh. I'm so sick of TV.
I have got, and me and Robert were just talking about this last night, but there was some program we was watching on Netflix the other week, and, you know, I hate commercials.
I hate them.
Robert hates commercials too because I hate them, but she hates them for a different reason. But we're watching TV. I'm going to have three programs going at one time. I'm going to watch this one till a commercial comes on. Until a commercial comes on, I'm going to change channel and watch this one. I'm going to watch this one until a commercial comes on. I'm going to change channel and watch this one. And you know, I really get mad when you go through four channels and all the commercials are synchronized. Oh, that just puts me over the edge. But we were watching this program. And every now and then, there'd be one of them dirty words in there. And at first, you know, first couple episodes, I thought, well, you know, they just drop one every now and then. It's okay. We can kind of overlook that. But by about the fourth episode, every time one of them words, and there's just a couple of them, it was just grating on them. So we didn't even watch the rest of the series. And it's hard to go through now and find programming, TV programming, that don't have all of that or sex in it. And so, the small choices you make about what you listen to, little things, what you watch. Because I remember the song we used to sing in Sunday school, vacation, high school. Be careful, little eyes, what you see. Be careful, little ears, what you hear. Be careful, little feet, where you go. Be careful, little hands, what you do. The Father up above, He's watching all the time, knows what we see and do. So, our eye gate and our ear gate. And you know that. There's only two ways that things get into our inner being. We come in through the eye gate, we see them, or come in through the ear gate, we hear them. So making small choices, making small compromises, oh, we can just listen to that. Or, oh, we can just watch that. I ask the Lord to make my stomach turn every time they say one of them words. And if you do that, then you get off of them channels and you end up watching a lot of Hallmark. I guarantee you I can watch the storyline of Hallmark movie in the first 3 minutes when it comes on. But that's okay. They're clean. You know, they're not full of profanity and vulgarity. They're not full of illicit sex. So we have to be careful. Small choices. Small kind of, well, it won't hurt me to listen to that. Oh, it won't hurt me to watch that. You better be careful. You know, slip up and hold. What about our church attendance? Oh, me.
Oh, wow.
Oh, me. Well, let's go one step further then. What about our RU attendance? I got to have it on Friday night.
Yeah.
Hey, there's some people here that are not here tonight that we haven't seen 2 or 3 weeks. There's some that are regular here that we haven't seen in a while. What's happened? They made a little compromise there. You know, Ashley said it's love. Nick said it's self, or somebody who was said it's self. I started, Randy said, I started not to come tonight. Satan said, you've worked hard all week, you're tired, you need to rest. Satan told you, you're having a little difficulty with that health-wise, you small choices. Church attendance, how are you attending? About how we treat others. Nick touched on this, and I can kind of, I just don't have a, I don't have a giggly, bubbly, effervescent personality. That's not the fact that, you know, I can walk in a room and be in a room with you, and we don't even have to talk. I should be different. And I tried to do that tonight, and I can't even go around and speak to everybody. Talk to everybody. Be kind to people. Be courteous. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. No, ma'am. I still say that to people. I don't know whether they're older than me or not. Just be courteous. How we treat other people respectfully. Listen to what they have to say. We don't have to agree with them. We don't have to condone what they say. Just listen to them. Just let it go and listen to them. So how we treat others. You know, I think about that. I think about the simple things that we do and how they have an impact on our life and these choices that we make about these small things and how compromising them can bring us to a place of disaster. And I got to thinking a little bit about our days, our daily routines, and how things impact us. I know some people, and you may be one, and I'm not trying to be critical or negative. Some people have their routine. They get up in the morning, get the shower, get the clothes on, out the door, in the car, go through the drive-thru, get their coffee or their breakfast or whatever, into the office. Things click, 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 click. And I know some people that every morning, in their daily simple little routine, their coffee and their biscuit or their coffee and their hash brown, whether they spend $5 or $6, every morning. And then the same thing at lunchtime, and go out and eat, like every day. You know, think about it just a minute. If you took 15 more minutes at home, put you a couple pieces of bread in the toaster and made you a cup of coffee at home, you would save yourself that $6 or $8, $10 every morning. That's $50 a week. That's $200 a month. That can just be saved. Now, I'm not a financial guru, but I'm trying to help you understand how small choices and things that we do every day have a big impact in our life. I mean, that's $200 a month right there. You can take $50 of that $200 to turn around and to buy your coffee and your bread for your toast in the morning and still clear $150 of what you've been spending the previous month. That's pretty big impact. Pretty big impact, right? I mean, $150 a month is pretty good loan. So you see, all I'm trying to help you do is understand that the small choices that we make and the things that we do in our everyday life, making those choices can have a big impact. And all of those simply involve, most of them, time. You know what? We all have the same amount of time in a day. I have just as many minutes in a day as you do. So how can you look at your neighbor, your friend, who's being productive for the Lord, who's working and serving the Lord, who's having victories in their life day after day after day after day, and you think, oh, I wish I could do that. I wish I could be that way. You know what my answer to that is? Pay attention to the small things.
Yep.
Pay attention to the small. Just like that coffee and biscuit routine in the morning, you can save yourself $200 a month by paying a little attention to the decisions you make about small things for the Lord, daily devotion, prayer time, being kind to others, engaged in service, just rearranging, learning to manage your time, and investing time in those little small things every day, day in and day out, simple things will make a big impact in your spiritual life. Don't we want a big change? Don't we want our spiritual lives to be impacted and growing and victorious every day? Certainly we do. Well, then we need to be careful about the little small things that we make, little small decisions, and don't let them go. I commend anybody that pushes on through a hard spot to get somewhere. It's like coming to RU on Friday night. Because I know, because my wife and I, every Friday morning in our prayer time together, our devotion, we pray for RU students because we know that Satan is going to be waiting to trip you up, to keep you from making it in on Friday night. We know that. So we pray ahead. Lord, don't let Satan rob them today. The get it all those ways. We have to make that small decision, that little decision. No, I'm going to push through. No, I'm going to make the time. I need to go here. I need to go there. I need to do this. No, I need to go to church tonight. I need to be in our youth. I need to read my Bible today. I need to spend this time in prayer today. Small little time decision. When we compromise them, it trips us up. So, small compromises do lead to great disaster.
Amen.
And the greatest disaster of all is when Satan gets hold of our life and robs us of the victory and the joy of our salvation. That's a disaster. So I have to be careful. I have to pay attention on what I listen to, what I watch, what I say, where I go, and the little small things I do every day. Mm-hmm. Rearrange my life. I have to do it. And I know you do too. And if we don't, we'll stumble. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for a few minutes to realize this truth about small compromises. Lord, I pray that if there's one here tonight that struggles with that area of compromising on these sorts of decisions that we've mentioned, Lord, I pray you trouble their heart, that remind them, point out to them the places where they could do better and to make changes. And like we've already said, Lord, that so many of these things that we talk about, these compromises, so many times they just involve a little Lord, I pray you make us wise to Satan and his tricks. Make us wise to the way he would distract us and cause us to compromise. And give us the courage, the strength, the determination, the dedication, the aggressiveness, the zeal to push ahead, to go on through and make the right choice. Lord, I thank you for this time together here tonight. Thank you for our time around the table and our fellowship.